Ladies and gentlemen, this is William Head with NorthNashvilleTV.com at the Northwest YMCA, talking to Dr. Donald Alcindor. Doc, good morning to you.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm blessed. So this is an event that seems like there would be a whole lot more people out here, but...
Well, we're waiting. You know, it goes on for about 3 or 4 hours. So we know that Saturday morning is very special to a lot of people. They tend to get up later. And again, if they're caring for babies, because this is a big baby shower, this is a baby shower for all of Nashville. And we're here to support the health and wellness of mothers and their babies today. And vaccinations are key to protecting mothers and babies from infectious diseases.
Well, you impressed me so much the other day. I went and got all mine done at the same time.
Glad to hear it.
At Walgreens.
Glad to hear it.
You speak of vaccinations and mothers to be, women who are pregnant or expect to get pregnant. What is your advice on when and what immunization they should seek?
Yes. So first of all, COVID. We know that pregnant women that get infected with COVID that are unvaccinated have a higher risk of symptomatic disease to COVID, hospitalizations, ICU administrations, and they can be put under ECMO and mechanical ventilation, and they have a higher risk of death. And so the mRNA vaccines that are out there right now, that includes the new updated monovalent COVID-19 vaccine, is available, and pregnant women are eligible. And that includes pregnant women, women that are breastfeeding, and recently delivered moms as well. And so other vaccines that are very important for pregnant women includes Tdap and influenza. Back in the day, influenza was a killer of pregnant women before the vaccine. And so diphtheria, tetanus, and pertussis is a very important vaccination for women, and it is required, recommended by ACOG and all of the maternal people that are involved in maternal health say that Tdap is required for pregnant women each and every time they become pregnant.
I was talking to Dr. Etheridge before I found you, and we talked about the incidence of infant mortality in this country and this state. Can you speak to that?
Yes, infant mortality is growing, and we know that infant mortality is also associated with maternal mortality as well. And again, this is about health and wellness of babies, and we know that certain individuals that are pregnant are not going to their prenatal visits because they may be uninsured or underinsured. And the idea is that if something were to happen to the baby, it's very important that the pediatrician knows first. And the way the pediatrician knows first is that a woman that is pregnant attend all of her prenatal visits and be able to monitor baby from day one to delivery. And so that's very important. And again, we would expect that to reduce the level of infant mortality. We know that infectious disease play a part in infant mortality, but again, we need to protect mothers and babies all along the way. From conception to delivery, babies need to be monitored for diseases of all sorts, other abnormalities that can have a clinical significance. And of course, mothers and fathers need to listen to their physicians going forward in any pregnancy.
Dr. Kim noted the fact that the infant mortality rate in this state is exacerbated by the fact that the state did not fund Medicaid further. Talk about that, would you?
Yes. And so we know that expansion of Medicaid is very important for many people that are underinsured or uninsured. And so without expansion of Medicaid, you increase the number of people that have access to medical services. That includes an OBGYN. We know that in some counties in Tennessee, there are no OBGYNs to support pregnancy care. And so what we need is to establish healthcare infrastructure that extends to rural communities and the opportunity for all pregnant women to have insurance and be covered for their medical needs.
With the advent of the right for a woman to take care of her reproductive health, as decided by the Supreme Court, the country is asking women not to abort children, but our state is doing nothing to assist women who have children.
Yeah, turns out abortion has become so political, even more so in conservative states like Tennessee and conservative counties, in particular rural counties. And I think when it comes to abortion, it should be optional for women, because women should be the final deciders of what they do with their bodies. And the idea, it's a moral choice, but again, that choice should be available to them. Women shouldn't have to leave Tennessee to go out of state to have abortions and to get maternal care and so forth. So I think it's an option. It's an option that's based on the choosing of the women and their families, and I think it should not be political.
The circumstance with the legislatures all over the country who are making these, I would say, asinine decisions about a woman's health seem to forget that most of the people who are making decisions are no longer able to provide any assistance in the lady getting pregnant, much less have anything to do with the birth of a child. It bothers me no end that old men, old gray-haired men like me, are making decisions for a young woman and how her life will proceed. What avenue do we have to at least try to make this thing a little bit more common sense?
I think what you're looking at, trying to interact with your Congress people. You have the right to protest. You have the right to write to your congressman. You have the right to gather and express your opinions, and that shouldn't be held up. But I think when abortion and maternal health care is being used as a political pawn to be able to be elected for office, I think that's a sad day that we've come to in the U.S., and I think it happens all too often.
Well, there are a lot of sadness in this country as it relates to politics. At Meharry, you do a jam-up job with the provision of COVID-19 vaccine. You did last year. The parking lot on Charlotte Avenue stayed full, and your people were out there working diligently. What is the process of getting, or is there a process for getting COVID-19 on the Meharry campus or Meharry site?
There is. And so from the beginning of the pandemic, Meharry has been in the forefront of basically bringing underserved, that is medically underserved communities, the opportunity to test for COVID and of course to get COVID vaccinations. It was very clear in the beginning that underserved minority communities may not have access. And so Meharry partnered with the Bloomberg Philanthropies to acquire a mobile vaccination unit. And the idea is that we went to those communities in need in a mobile unit. We met them where they are. So we parked our unit in the backyard of MDHA housing, and we brought vaccines and testing to the folks that needed it most. We've continued to do this in terms of providing vaccinations on our campus. And of course, if you're at any of our vaccine events, you're able to come and get that vaccine for free. Currently, the new monovalent COVID-19 vaccine supplies are relatively limited. And so we have partnered with Walgreens in order to bring people that vaccine at our community vaccination events. And Walgreens have been very good at providing that service in terms of providing the vaccines for people that have insurance. And those that don't have insurance are going to be subject to being part of a bridge program that's being sponsored by the CDC to give uninsured individuals or underinsured individuals free vaccination. There are also opportunities for them to get free COVID tests. And the idea is that if they're in a position where they need COVID testing, they have symptoms associated with COVID at the time, then testing is recommended. And so we can provide those tests to people free at our vaccination events. We also provide masks as well. We give updated information on what the COVID-19 vaccine is all about in terms of, this is a new vaccine, it's not a booster. And this vaccine has been updated from the original bivalent Omicron booster. This is an updated new COVID-19 vaccine that is based on a virus that is somewhat currently circulating in the general population. So as the virus evolves and our immune system wanes, we have to update our vaccines to keep up with the virus that's ever changing. And so we've done that. We are a part of this. We will continue to do this. And today we are here at the Nashville Baby Shower to deliver vaccine information and of course, clinical trial information for people at our event. So Meharry is also sponsoring clinical trials with our CMV VIDE trial. It's a vaccine trial looking at cytomegalovirus infection in pregnant women that can lead to problems for the baby. We're also doing a lenacapavir trial with HIV. This is an HIV PrEP trial. And again, this is a medication that's part of an injection, two injections for the entire year, as opposed to taking a pill a day for your HIV PrEP prophylaxis. And so we think that this is very important. We've also partnered with the University of California, San Francisco, as part of their RECOVER trial that includes bringing in mothers and babies, particularly minorities and mothers and babies, into this trial, because for the longest time, African Americans and Hispanics have not participated at the level of what they represent in a general population in clinical trials. And again, the NIH has been put on notice to include African Americans and Hispanics and minorities and women in clinical trials. Since 1993, we speed along 40 years to this day. That has yet to happen, and it's actually gotten worse. And so we continue to push on. We are doing clinical trials at our vaccine events routinely now, and we're looking for people that are willing to participate.
Well, I've got a site in my backyard in Lebanon, Tennessee, that I'll be happy to let you to park your van or whatever it is.
Sounds
and
great.
Do all you want to do.
Sounds great.
This has been The Good Doctor, Dr. Donald L. Sindor. I'm William Head, and this is NorthNashvilleTV.com.